On the 22nd of July 2004, an amendment to the UK's electrical safety regulations, known as Part P, was laid before Parliament to be ratified. It prescribed safe zones on walls where electrical cables could be installed, and it specifically dictated that cables must always run in those safe zones and must always run perfectly vertically or perfectly horizontally so that everyone knew where they were after they'd been hidden behind drywall or plaster render. 1 week after that parlimentary sitting, on the 31st of July 2004, the daughter of one of those very parliamentarians, whose name I won't mention to protect her privacy, was electrocuted and killed in her own home. It turned out that back in 1999, she and her husband had had a new kitchen fitted, and unbeknown to them, an electrical cable connecting an extractor fan had been bodged in at a 5-degree angle instead of dead vertical. 2 years later, the husband installed a wall-mounted metal dish drainer below that extractor in a zone that he assumed to be safe, but one of the screws just breached the outer insulation of the badly fitted cable. As the drainer moved a bit over time, that screw finally came into contact with the live conductor, making the drain alive. One day soon after that, his wife placed a metal utensil on the drainer, while one of her bare feet also happened to be touching the metal front of their dishwasher. That made an electrical circuit that killed her instantly, at the exact same time that legislation was being passed to prevent precisely that kind of tragedy. So the question is, should the electrician who installed that cable be held responsible for that person's death? After all, even though he almost certainly knew what he was doing was extremely dangerous, the new rules didn't exist at the time he installed the cable, and 5 years had passed. So was it really his problem? The reason I share this story, if it hasn't already clicked, is that it serves as a gruesome but very apposite allegory for the way we humans are collectively bodging our planet's natural system boundaries right now, with potentially lethal consequences, possibly even for us, but certainly for our descendants. And the reason I mention it now is because a group of the world's leading climate scientists has just published this very blunt new analysis outlining precisely what those system boundaries are, how badly we're currently bodging them, and what the consequences are likely to be for future generations, starting with our kids and grandkids. So the question is, should we be held responsible for the future safety of our descendants, or is it their problem? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. This new work was led by a guy called Professor Johan Rockström, who, as I'm sure many of you know, is director of the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research. At a recent gathering of some of the world's most eminent scientists called the Frontiers Forum, Rockström delivered an excellent 40-minute lecture summarising its contents. This video is based very closely on that presentation, so if you prefer to get the details straight from the horse's mouth, and frankly I wouldn't blame you if you've got the time, then you can click up there somewhere to jump straight to that video, or follow the link to it that I've left in the description section below. If you're still watching this though, then here's my attempt at a potted summary. First of all, let's talk about the shift from a Holocene period to the so-called Anthropocene period that you've no doubt heard about in the news recently. This chart from a research team led by Matthew Osman from the University of Arizona shows how temperatures changed over the last 24,000 years. During the 11,000 years or so since the onset of this interglacial period, known as the Holocene, our planet's average surface temperature was 14 degrees Celsius, plus or minus 0.5 degrees. Temperatures never strayed towards 1 degree higher, let alone 1.5 or 2 degrees. Modern humans have been on the planet for about 200,000 years. As a species, we've lived through two ice ages and two interglacial periods. But it's only when we left the last ice age that conditions enabled us to shift from a few million hunter-gatherers to a more sedentary agricultural lifestyle with domesticated animals and fixed geographical positions that brought about the growth of the great civilizations, culminating in the global sprawl we have today. The reason for that stability has been a healthy biosphere. In other words, Earth's various planetary systems were always able to compensate for any natural variability and sort of mop up things like carbon, either in the oceans or in land sinks or in the atmosphere. Professor Rockström explains that the Holocene is the model we want to aim for as a set of proven safe boundaries for human development. But that's not where we are now. We're now in a new epoch called the Anthropocene, where the dominant driver of planetary conditions is not Earth's own calibration systems, but human or anthropogenic forcing. And this isn't just about the climate crisis, by the way. Rockström and his team take a more holistic view that considers the impacts of things like future global pandemics, like the one we all recently experienced, regional conflicts like the war in Ukraine that can disrupt food and energy supplies, and an ecological crisis that Rockström says has already wiped out 70% of the populations of vertebrate animals over the course of the last 70 years, and which has driven 1 million of the 8 million known species on Earth either to extinction or to a point of very serious extinction risk in the coming decades. The fundamental challenge of the ecological crisis, says Rockström, is that we're losing the ability for moisture recycling, for carbon sequestration, and for food production, and we're putting ourselves at increasing risk of what the scientists call zoonotic disease outbreaks, which is essentially what COVID was. Last year was the fifth warmest on record, despite there having been 3 years of La Niña conditions in the South Pacific, which normally tend to cool our global atmosphere a bit. It was also the most expensive year ever in terms of loss and damage, costing more than $300 billion globally. We're now moving into an El Niño phase, which tends to cause additional global warming. And you can click up there somewhere to jump over to my video looking at that phenomenon. Rockström suggests that El Niño conditions could briefly bump us into temperatures that are 1.5 degrees Celsius higher than 1850 to 1900 levels as early as 2024. That may prove to be a freak single year this time around, but it'll certainly give us an idea of the longer term direction of travel. Nature has done its bit to compensate for our profligacy though. It continued to do a lot of mopping up, even as our species learnt how to exponentially accelerate our consumption and emissions as a result of the discovery of fossil fuels at the start of the Industrial Revolution. To get an idea of just how much we've leveraged our own human and animal power, we can look at oil. A single barrel of crude oil contains an amount of energy roughly equivalent to the amount of work that a single human labourer working 8 hours a day, every single day, would take almost 8 years to achieve. And in 2023, the world will be producing 100 million barrels of oil every single day. Essentially, the planet has absorbed 50% of the impact of our activities over the last 170 years or so. That's basically a massive, unaccounted for subsidy to the world economy. Because if nature hadn't mopped up the extra carbon dioxide and heat, we would have had to deal with the consequences, which of course would have cost a lot of money and severely curtailed global economic growth. The slight wrinkle, as Rockström points out, is that all the models in the IPCC Sixth Assessment Report that we took a look at in this video assume that this extremely helpful planetary activity will carry on indefinitely. But all the research shows that cracks are now appearing in those systems. So we've got things like the Amazon rainforest shifting from a net carbon sink to a net carbon emitter, which we looked at in this video. And a similar phenomenon is happening in the forests of Northern Europe and Canada. And then there's the oceans. They've absorbed 95% of the extra heat and more than 30% of the extra carbon dioxide that we've produced since the Industrial Revolution. The upcoming El Niño might just give us a taster of what it may be like if that energy is released back out of our oceans and into our atmosphere over relatively short timescales. So the future, according to Rockström and his team, and by the way, plenty of other analysts around the world as well, is not just about building out millions of windmills and solar panels to decarbonise our world economy, important though that is. It's fundamentally really about staying within the Earth System Boundaries, or ESBs, outlined in his paper. And to that end, Rockström insists that 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels is a limit that we really can't just go sailing past and say, oh well, never mind. It's not an arbitrary number, and it's certainly not some politically motivated compromise plucked out of thin air, as some sceptics suggest. It's a genuine planetary boundary beyond which we will begin to invoke some of the tipping points that Rockström and his team mapped out way back in 2009 and updated in 2015 on this global chart. Now, it's extremely important that people like me don't give the impression that phrases like Greenland ice sheet collapse mean an immediate disintegration like a house of cards causing 7 meters of sea level rise by next Tuesday. It could take hundreds of years for some of these consequences to play out in their entirety. But just like a clumsy teenager overturning their chair, once the tipping point is passed, there's no going back until the consequences play out to their conclusion. As we take a tour around this global map, you start to see that those consequences are not just up in the Arctic either, and not even just up here in the Northern Hemisphere. They stretch right across the globe, from east to west and from north to south. Four of them are likely to happen if we go above 1.5 degrees Celsius of warming. Another two will likely occur if we hit 2 degrees Celsius of additional warming, and another four, including dieback of the Amazon rainforest, start between 2 and 3.7 degrees, which is where our current global policies are taking us to by the end of this century. And just to press home the point about risks to global stability, Professor Rockstrom provides us with this global map created by a research team at Exeter University here in the UK, showing what they refer to as the future of the human climate niche. And this one is a particularly cheery little number. The country colours represent economic stability, with blues and greens denoting relatively stable economies, oranges and reds denote comparatively unstable economies, and the darkest red represents the least stable. On top of that, the team overlay a heat risk map. These solid black sections are regions that already currently experience average annual temperatures greater than 29 degrees Celsius. At the moment, those conditions are confined to the Sahara Desert, but these hashed areas show regions that will also experience average annual temperatures greater than 29 degrees Celsius within 50 years if we continue on our current trajectory. That's an annual average that brings regular temperature spikes where human outdoor survival is severely jeopardised. It includes Brazil, vast swathes of Northern Africa, a good chunk of India, and Southeast Asia. All told, that's about 3.5 billion people living in regions where the vulnerable, who can't afford air conditioning, will be forced to migrate elsewhere, good luck with that one, or simply die in situ. The summary of all this slightly mind-boggling information is the model that Rockstrom and his team refer to as the Planetary Boundary Framework, which would probably take at least another whole video to examine in detail, but which serves as a pretty useful quick visual reference for where we're at right now. Four of the nine boundaries have already been passed. The red zones are where we're now at high risk, including biosphere integrity and the use of phosphorus and nitrogen in agriculture. Orange represents areas of increasing risk like global warming and land use, and blue is where we're safe, which is almost nowhere at all. Now, if you're perhaps already in your 40s or like me in your 50s or older, then the chances are you won't be around in 50 years' time. So how bothered should you be about this information? Are you thinking, well, I don't live in one of those areas, and even if all the other near-term consequences of climate change like food shortages, economic breakdown, water scarcity, extreme weather events and all that other stuff do start to slightly impinge on my part of the world, with a bit of careful planning and some judicious stockpiling, I reckon I can probably get away with it until they finally put me in my box. Because if you are thinking that, then I would suggest you are no better than the electrician I talked about right at the start of this video. I know you can't solve all these problems by yourself any more than I can, but dealing with the four elements of the global crisis that Rockstrom highlighted earlier can only be achieved by fundamental changes in human behaviour. Governments and corporations are not untouchable, faceless entities. They're organisations run by human beings. That means they can be influenced in the right direction by other human beings. And those human beings are very definitely people like you and me. That's my view anyway, for what it's worth. There are, of course, loads of different opinions about how to address these issues, and no doubt one of those opinions is your opinion. So if you're currently feeling a burning desire to express that opinion, why not dive down to the comment section below here and leave your thoughts there. And I'll be very interested to see what the consensus view looks like. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to our fantastic Patreon supporters who enable me to run this channel on a full-time basis without having to include ads and sponsorship messages in any of my videos. And an extra special thank you to the folks whose names are scrolling up the screen beside me here, all of whom celebrated an anniversary of Patreon support in June. If you feel I've earned that level of support from you and you'd like the chance to influence future content, then you can do that over at patreon.com/justhaveathink, where you'll also get early access to all my videos, plus exclusive additional monthly content from me. And if you feel like I've earned your support here on YouTube, then you can demonstrate that absolutely for free by subscribing and hitting that like button. Dead easy to do. You just need to click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week if you can. And remember to just have a think. See you next week.